Yeah. Yeah.
Fire.
Yeah.
When Smallbit worked on Jet Set Radio and released it on their Sega in the year 2000, I doubt they thought their game would be so influential and loved by so many people around the world. But most people have probably played the localized versions of the game, and not the Japanese original version. What's the difference between them? Well, today I will try to answer that question bit by bit, comparing every detail I could find that was different between each version. Hi, I'm Sunset, and today we will learn a few things about Jet Set Radio that you probably didn't know. So, where to start? First, I will talk about each version we will analyze today. The first one will be the original Japanese release of the game. It was released on June 29th of the year 2000. The second version of the game, Jet Grind Radio, was released in North America in October 30th of the year 2000. It added two new levels and changed a few things as well. The European version is named Jet Set Radio and is pretty much the same as the North American one. However, it has a few different songs in its soundtrack. Then we will take a look at the second Japanese release of the game called Della Jet Set Radio. Apparently there is no recorded date of the release of this version, but it was released in 2001. It added all of the changes of the international releases, but it's closer to the European version of the game because of its soundtrack. It also has the European subtitles for English, Spanish, French, and German. Then, there's the GBA version. Yeah, we're not taking a look at that one. Not today, at least. Finally, we're going to take a look at the HD port of the game, released on September 19th of 2012. For most regions, Japan saw this version later, someday in 2013, I'll put it on the screen. I'm not quite sure what version it was based on, but I assume it could be either Grind or Della. Alright, with that explanation out of the way, how about we start our analysis with the Japanese version? The one with by far the most differences.
Jet Set Radio!
Alright, so besides the obvious stuff like the subtitles and language, what was different in the original Japanese release? What a great question. Well, to start, why don't we talk about the character names? A few were changed. Tab was Corn, Mew was Biz, Piranha was Sugar, and Slate was Soda. I guess they were changed because they were related to food. I can't say I'm sure because I don't know if Biz is some kind of Japanese dessert or food or something, and I'm too lazy to look it up. So if someone knows and can tell me, please do so. Related to the characters, we have one design change, which was honestly unnecessary. I'm talking about Cube. In the Japanese release and in the artwork for her, we can see that she wears a gray top with long black sleeves that have red flames on them, and some kind of symbol on the back. She also has dark blue jeans and a belt with a skull buckle. Pretty cool, huh? For the international release, some mad genius decided it would be a good idea to get rid of her outfit and redesign it. She got a black tank top with her name in Japanese written in the front of it, and some black skinny jeans instead of the ones she originally had. Okay, now, hear me out. So, I'm about to ruin Jet Set Radio for you, and I'm warning you about it, so be careful, you know? I'll make it unplayable. Are you ready to listen? Alright, here it goes. Cube's shadow model wasn't updated when her design was changed. Yep, your eyes are not deceiving you. It wasn't updated, and it's this way on every single release after the original Japanese one. I'm not making this shit up, seriously, I can't believe this mistake was made. I hope the guy that forgot to update it was fired. Literally unplayable. Okay, so this insult to us Cube fans conveniently leads us into the next topic, the character challenges. So if you don't know what they are, why are you watching this video in the first place? Well, in case someone doesn't know what they are, I will explain them. Basically, every unlockable character has a challenge you have to complete before you can play as them. They can either be a race or a sequence of tricks that the character challenges you to replicate. It's pretty simple, right? Well, some characters have different challenges. After the first level, Shibuya GG, you get a challenge from... Combo? Huh, it's pretty weird for him to show up this early in the game, but whatever. First, he asks you to grind on a rail and jump. It doesn't look so hard, and in fact it isn't. Then he has to tag a few graffitis on this health bar, which is also simple. And finally, you have to jump over these three roofs at the bus terminal. Wait, this challenge seems familiar. Oh, it was used for Piranha in the international release, holy shit! Yep, the symbol challenge was used for one of the last characters you can unlock in the game. I guess it's because Combo has a different challenge in the international version? It's a race against Blit. So, what did Piranha get in the Japanese release? The same as Combo, a race, so that's cool. Well, since we talked about Combo, why don't we check out Cube's challenge in the Japanese release? She appears after Benton Boogie, the first Benton level. Shouldn't this be Mew? The challenge is literally the same one. The only difference is this one plays Rocket on instead of Mischievous Boy like the international release. And Cube moans. She moans a lot in this version for some reason. Not that I'm complaining about it. Anyway, so since Cube had Mew's challenge, what's up with Mew? How do I get my man girl? After you beat Kogane Circus, she challenges you. Her challenge is in Kogane. So that's different. First, she fails to tag every single graffiti in this halfpipe. That one's a grade 1 developers. Really nice quality control. So after that mishap, she does a pretty sick trick in the construction area. It looks so fucking cool, and it's harder than it looks, so... yeah. Her last challenge is to grind on a few power lines down the rooftops on Kogane. I'm sad this challenge is the only one that got cut off from the international release. It could have fit another character, like, I don't know, Slate. I think the game had too many races, so, you know, it would be nice to have another challenge. So now that we've got the characters out of the way, are there any changes to the levels? Not really, not to the maps themselves, at least. I think the most notable change was the bosses. Every boss level but two were changed. So what are the differences? The maps are the same, it's just that the bosses have a kind of random pattern to them. You start further away from them and they have green arrows with no counter for the graffiti cans you are missing for the tag in their backs, unlike the international release that has a red arrow with the counter on its side. They definitely take longer to beat and also just very annoying to play. So I see why the international release fixed the boss patterns and had some quality of life improvements. Big thumbs up for that one, developers. Here's another change. You guys obviously remember DJ Professor K. He's like the coolest character in the game by far.
This is Tokyo's Gorilla Music Broadcaster, Jet Set Radio! Let's go to the mailbag. A letter from Mr. Osaki asks, how do I get rid of these nasty roaches? Easy, just burn your house down! Jet Set Radio! We got another letter from Osaki. He says, I burned my house down. What should I do now? How should I know, fool?
Anyway, Did you know he did the narration for the epilogue after the final fight in the original release? I prefer the one with Combo's voice, honestly. Here's the clips.
Jet Set Radio! That huge turntable of evil, the Rokuku building, is a pile of dust, right along with the Rokuku ski. Now they're saying that the building was destroyed in a construction accident. Yeah, right. But Goji's son has taken over the Rokuku family business, and Tokyo is back to its glorious old self. Now, the noise tanks are in repair. The love shockers are broken-hearted again, but Poison Jam is back and planning more mischief. Goji wanted to control the hearts of the people he couldn't buy with his money. Just another millionaire with a grudge. It's the root of all evil, they say. But it turns out the record he was looking for, the Devil's Contract, was just the old indie record. A hoax! Maybe the demons in his own heart created out of rumors and superstition. Or maybe that record really is somewhere here in Tokyo. Somewhere waiting to be found. But anyway, don't fret about that. DJ Professor K is gonna lay down some cool grooves to take away them blues.
That huge turntable of evil, the Rokuku building, is a pile of dust, right along with the Rokuku ski. Now they're saying that the building was destroyed in a construction accident. Yeah, right. But now, Goji's son is taking over the Rokuku family business, and Tokyo is back to its glorious old self. Turns out that the Golden Rhinos were just another group of Goji's henchmen. That explains a lot. However, not all ended well. Coin had been pulled too deep into the schemes of the Rokuku and paid a steep price. And all because Goji was obsessed with control. He didn't know how to deal with people that he couldn't buy with his money. Maybe he really is lonely at the top. Or maybe he's just another eccentric millionaire. Let us say that money is the root of all evil. Maybe it really can twist the hearts of men. It turns out the record that Goji was looking for, the Devil's Contract, was just an old indie record, a hoax. Maybe his twisted mind created the whole story out of rumors and superstitions in order to try and sate the demons of his own heart. Nevertheless, the noise tanks are in repair. The love shockers are all broken-hearted again, but Poison Jam is back and planning more mischief. In the end, it looks like they were the same as all of us after all. They'd been looking for something more, just trying to make sense of their own lives. Perhaps not, but how can anyone know the real truth behind it all?
The credits, with the character you pick running around Shibuya's bus terminal doing tricks and stuff, are different in this version. Your character tags some unique graffiti with the names of the developers in them, and I like it a lot more than the international release. It just looks cooler. Next stop is Jet Grind Radio.
Jet Grind Radio!
Gosh, that title screen shout is awful. Now, the thing with this version of the game is that I won't talk about it too much because Della just has all the things and added plus a few more. So, I won't take too long on this one. Here the characters have their localized names and their localized voice lines, so that's pretty obvious. Cube's redesign was introduced as well as a new story. Gombo and Cube are now from Grind City in the US. Basically just New York, and they're looking for answers after their friend Coin was kidnapped and then murdered by the assassins the Rokaku group had hired. Now we're moving on to De La Jet Set Radio.
Jet Set Radio!
De La Jet Set Radio is based on the European version of the localization. It has all the levels and graffiti that were added with Jet Grind Radio, and it also plays a bit better. I feel it has more polish and care put into it. So, since we're playing with the English subtitles, sometimes the game gets awfully confused and just picks the original Japanese names for the characters when they are speaking. And after their challenges, it displays their localized name. It also has some audio in Japanese and some in English, so it's a weird mess. Another difference comes in the Grind City levels. I have avoided talking too much about the music so far because that's just a whole mess and a half, and I want to dedicate a separate bit of the video to it. So basically the soundtracks between Jet Grind Radio and De La are different. Jet Grind has some metal playing on the Bantam Street and Grind Square levels, while the European or De La versions have some more electronic sounding music. All of it is licensed, and we will go more in depth with the music in a bit. Besides that, really, De La is a great time. Honestly, this would be my favorite version of the game if it wasn't for the awful Dreamcast control scheme. They could have fixed the camera using the buttons that just aren't used in the controller at all. They didn't bother for some reason. Oh, I'm also forgetting, Jet Grind introduced a tutorial to the game, and it's the hardest level. Yep, you heard me right, it's the hardest level. And if you don't believe me, ask the 95.5% of Steam owners that have never beaten it. Well, that's a nice transition onto the HD version, which is the best one.
Jet Set Radio!
It adds a bunch of things that are just really nice to have. So, okay, let me explain, because it's a lot. It adds some new graffiti to the game, some were made by fans and were submitted to Sega on a contest, and that was pretty cool. And some look really awesome. It also has the achievements in the Steam version, which are a welcome addition just for those completionists out there, like me. It also has online leaderboards for the score in each level, and it adds a bonus menu that has the Jet Set Radio documentary called The Rude Awakening. It's a nice watch if you're a huge Jet Set Radio fan, or just are interested in the development of the game. I could do a video on it someday too, so, you know, consider subscribing, just saying. Anyway, it also has the Jet Set Radio Future soundtrack as an unlockable feature.
Fly like a butterfly. I ain't a winner. Pay the front line, take the don'ts. He's coming out again for a new point. Get your... Thank you.
Just another middle finger from Sega to those people asking for Future to get ported to PC. And you know what? I think it never will be ported, so mark my words. This version also adds a proper camera to the game, so now it can be enjoyed fully. Thank you, Sega. Or fuck you, Sega. The HD version is censored, but it's pretty minor, so let's talk about it. Basically, the only censorship that makes sense is the word motherfuckers on the track Just Got Wicked. We will talk about that more in depth in the music section, but the other censorship is just bullshit. So I'm sure you guys are, you know, familiar with the Red Cross organization. You know, the ones that go to countries affected by, I don't know, hurricanes or earthquakes or whatever. They basically help people. Well, the thing is, back in the day, they went on a crusade, throwing lawsuits around for the use of red crosses on media. I swear, I'm not making this shit up. They sued Blink-182 for the Enema of the State cover, because the nerds had a red cross on their hat. And the motherfuckers won. So yeah, fuck the Red Cross. Anyway, there's some red crosses on Jet Set Radio, like on a drugstore or on some billboards around Benton. And those had to be censored to avoid lawsuits. So another cool feature that the PC port has is the ability to mod your own custom graffiti into it. And don't worry about it, because it's just super simple to do. You literally can't fuck it up. I swear, if you fuck this up, I'm gonna go to your house and fucking kill you. No, yeah, I don't think I will. I'll leave the tool in the description, and I'll also give you a small tutorial for it. Basically, all you need is a copy of the game, the images you want for the custom graffiti, and the tool itself. So let's say you like Mew a lot, like really, really, really like Mew, and you saw this cool piece of Mew fan art on the internet. So you saved it, and now you want to make a graffiti of her thighs in the game. Well, lucky for you, this tool can help you out. You just need to crop those thighs. After that, you locate the Jet Radio folder inside your Jet Set Radio files, and you open it with the replacer program. Then you click on the graffiti that you want to replace, click import, and add your custom image to the game. Then hit save on the program, and that's it. You can go around town painting your favorite ship images or your favorite thigh pictures. Have fun! Don't forget to click on the e_grf.afs file. That's the one that contains the files for the graffitis. You don't pick the other ones. If you pick the other ones, you're stupid and I can't help you. Alright, so now it's time to jump into the biggest mess of them all. The music. Jet Set Radio has one of the best soundtracks for a video game ever made. It just fits in so well with the game, and you can't help but jam to it. Every single track is a banger. It's really good stuff. So, the thing is, some tracks are either not present in certain versions, or flat out missing. On the screen, you should see a wall of text with all the songs that appear in every version of the game. The Naganuma tracks, the David Soul ones, and the ones with Guitar Vader, and other Japanese artists. Okay, cool. So now we will talk about the songs that aren't on that list. For the Japanese version, we have Donny Boy Williamson Show by David Soul, which is the exclusive track for it. Then, for Jet Grind Radio, we have Dragula by Rob Zombie. Yes, fucking Rob Zombie is in Jet Set Radio. Slow by Professional Murder Music. And Just Got Wicked by Cold, which is censored because it says motherfuckers in the lyrics, as I mentioned a bit ago. The European release and Della have Recipe for the Perfect Afro by Featurecast, Many Styles by OB1, and Funky Blocker by Semi Detached. Both localizations have Improvise by Jurassic 5 and Patrol Knob by Mix Master Mike. The HD version has all the tracks listed except for Many Styles, Yappy Feet, and Donny Boy Williamson Show. Hi, this is Future Sunset. So what happened was that while I was scripting the video, I completely forgot about the graffiti because, you know, I just thought I'll glance over it and I'll talk about that later, and then I completely forgot about it. And when I was recording the original audio, I completely forgot that I had to talk about the graffiti. So, well, in the screen you should be seeing a page of graffiti. I'm basically scrolling through every single one of them. So something to note about the graffiti is that basically the Japanese version, you know, it has different colors, as I mentioned a second ago. The re-releases, like what would be, you know, Jet Grind Radio, the European version, and Bella, all of them have different graffiti, you know, from the Japanese version, and then the HD one. Now, the thing with the HD one is that, you know, I mentioned in the very briefly I mentioned in the HD part of the video, I mentioned that Sega held a contest and basically fans submitted different graffiti to it, and, you know, Sega picked every single one that they liked. Some people submitted like full sets, and Sega only picked one of them, like one of the graffitis, and that was really shitty from them. But generally, you know, I think Sega doesn't do that kind of stuff anymore, you know, like that kind of community sense that, you know, that the kind of event had. Really, Sega doesn't do that anymore, and, you know, it's kind of sad, really. I hope something like that gets done if another future... I hope something like that gets done if another Jet Set Radio game, you know, comes out in the future. So yeah, that would really wrap up everything about this video. This game is amazing. All the different things that have changed about it through the years are really interesting. At least they were to me, and I hope they were for you too. If you're still wondering about what the best version to play is, I would go for either Della or the Steam port. That camera fix is just so convenient. I want to give a huge thanks to the guys over at the Jet Set Radio Wiki. Without them, the music section would have been a shot in the dark, pretty much. I also want to thank Chris Dareware for developing the custom graffiti tool I will link in the description. Sorry if I butcher your name. Also, thank you so much for watching this video. It has been a huge amount of work, but I know it will pay off. Please consider subscribing if you want to. I will be uploading more Jet Set Radio and Sega related videos in the future. I also do speedruns of this game from time to time, so check those out if you feel like it. Thank you all, and I will see you next time.